Good afternoon. Welcome to our Tuesday session. Today we welcome Dr. Ashlay Huitema. Ashlay is a cardiologist with the St. Joseph's Healthcare in London. And about a year and a half or so ago, we were fortunate to have Ashlay join our UHN program as a cardiac rehab fellow. So I will pass it over to Ashlay for a great session on heart failure.
Hi, everyone, and thanks for attending today. We're going to start our presentation and talking about heart failure. So our objectives today are to talk about what heart failure is, what's our definition and different types that we have, how can you manage your heart failure, and what sort of self-management techniques or tools can you use to manage heart failure better, how does cardiac rehab help with heart failure, and then finally, I think it's difficult to talk about a topic these days without discussing exactly how COVID-19 will affect you and how it will affect those living with heart failure. So we'll start with kind of our most basic definition. Heart failure is just wanted to make sure you guys are seeing the right slide. Heart failure is also known as congestive heart failure, CHF. It's a problem with how the heart pumps. And the heart can't pump enough blood around the body, especially during times of stress. So that can be physical, emotional stress, exerting yourself when it's very hot outside, as it is today here in Ontario. So all of those things can be cause stress and can cause your heart to have difficulty keeping up with demands. There's generally two different types of heart failure that we talk about. So systolic heart failure is where we talk about the pumping chambers of the heart not being able to squeeze enough blood out to the rest of the body. And this is often because the chambers of the heart are weak. And when heart chambers are weak over time, they can actually dilate and become bigger. So you may have heard people say that they have an enlarged heart, and that can often be associated with systolic heart failure. Diastolic heart failure has to do more with stiff chambers of the heart, and that the heart has difficulty filling with enough blood. So if the chambers are stiff, you can imagine that it's hard to get blood in, and that can mean there's not enough blood to pump out. And so that can be from a variety of reasons, most common being high blood pressure, but also there can be things that can infiltrate into the muscle and other causes that can cause diastolic heart failure. And this is a type of heart failure that's been on the rise over the past couple of decades. And now we see about 50-50 when it comes to systolic and diastolic heart failure, which is very different from what it was before. Common causes of heart disease, we've talked about some of them, are heart failure. Certainly they can be things that we take in. So heavy alcohol or drug use can cause heart failure. Risk factors such as diabetes, high blood pressure can cause other problems such as coronary artery disease, but also cause heart failure in their own accord. Family history can also play into it. So there are certain families that unfortunately can have genetic cardiomyopathies, and that can lead to heart failure. And you can also get heart rhythm disorders that cause heart failure. Valve problems, heart attacks can congenital heart problems, which mean things that you're born with, and sleep apnea are also other reasons for heart failure. When it comes to weak pumping function of the heart, coronary artery disease is the most common reason that the left side of the heart can be weak. So it's a common reason for left-sided heart failure. So that can be certainly an issue with our patients with coronary artery disease. So we've talked about what the definition of heart failure is, but what does it actually look like? And I'm going to play you a short video here. So I'm hoping that this all works out. And this is a video developed by the American College of Cardiology, and just give a really good description about heart failure and the journey.
So you have heart failure. That sounds scary. But it doesn't mean that your heart has stopped working. It still works, but it is weaker than before and can't pump enough blood to meet all your body's needs. Yes, there's a reason you've been so tired. It's okay to feel scared. Most people do. You may feel as though your world is turned upside down. It's also normal to be flooded by lots of big emotions. Some expected, some not. Fear and uncertainty about the future. Denial. Guilt. Heart failure is a journey. There will be bumps in the road, but you can learn to live with it one step at a time. Remember, you're not alone. There are over 6 million adults living with heart failure in the U.S. You can do it too. How? Speak up and use your voice. Tell your care team what matters most to you. You are the most important part of your team. So be your own heart champion and turn heart failure into your success. Ask tough questions. State your treatment goals to your care team. Stay active with hobbies. Enlist friends and family to join you. Find support and tips from other people with heart failure. And celebrate life. All of this is called being empowered. Look out, heart failure. Here we come.
All right, so it gives you an idea there of just the journey that is heart failure. And I think it's important to recognize that those living with heart failure really aren't alone. So we saw the American estimate there, but it is estimated over 600,000 Canadians are living with heart failure and that millions around the world are also affected. It is a condition that's on the rise and becoming more and more common as patients do survive more acute heart attacks and other acute heart conditions and live longer. We are seeing more and more patients with heart failure. So this is something that's going to come up again. When we're talking about symptoms of heart failure, certainly people can experience a vast variety of symptoms similar to patients experiencing a heart attack. So certain patients may experience some symptoms and not others, or others may get the whole gamut. Extreme tiredness or weakness, feeling lightheaded, swelling in the ankles, feet, legs, or tummy, shortness of breath, and this can be especially when lying flat or exercising, rapid or irregular heartbeats, and rapid changes in weight. So we'll talk about the importance of monitoring these sort of symptoms. Unfortunately, there is no cure to heart failure in most situations. It is important that you know there are lifestyle changes and treatments that can help you to manage your condition, and that many patients lead a normal and full life with heart failure. As we've heard already in the video, heart failure is a journey, and sometimes it can be a journey that, you know, the path can look like it's somewhat obscured, and it can be full of a few ups and downs. So I think it's important to know that your healthcare team is here for you, and that you define your journey, and you are the most important person in that healthcare team. When you take charge of your health and learn to manage your heart failure, it can help you to improve your quality of life. You can feel confident that you can manage your heart failure. You can feel in control of your condition. It helps you to know when to ask for help from your healthcare team. It can limit the need to go to the hospital for care, and it can prevent or limit complications related to heart failure as the disease progresses. So all of these reasons are why we're starting with a little bit of knowledge today, and giving you some tools to help with the self-management of the condition. So physical health is a really important aspect of heart failure care, and we're going to focus on that today, because that's sort of my area of expertise. And we're going to talk specifically about monitoring for symptoms and weighing yourself every morning, taking your medications as directed, watching your salt intake and choosing heart-healthy foods, and getting regular exercise while knowing your limits. So the Heart and Stroke has come out with some really good materials, and they base the heart failure assessment on three zones using kind of a stoplight technology or stoplight model. And I think it's really effective to kind of get the point across and to help with understanding kind of what you should do, because there are a lot of moving parts in managing heart failure. And we're going to start with talking about a few key ones that will really help your healthcare providers to help make good decisions and terms of your care. So they recommend that every day you weigh yourself in the morning before breakfast. So I usually say first thing in the morning after you go to the bathroom, but before you get dressed, hop onto the scale and write down your weight and look at it in comparison to what you were the day before. Keep the total amount of fluids you drink per day to around 2 liters or 6 to 8 standard glasses. It's important to take your medicine exactly how your doctor has prescribed it. Check for swelling in your feet, ankles, legs, and stomach every day. So the important part is noticing changes. So not being critical of your body necessarily, but just noting what's normal for you and knowing when there's a difference from day to day, eating foods that are low in salt or salt-free, and balancing activity and rest periods. So this is especially important when we're experiencing extreme heat like we are today, knowing what your body needs and paying attention to your limitations. When we talk about writing down your weights, it is really important to have sort of a consistent way of keeping track of things. This is a good chart that you can use. It also has the heart failure zones, which we'll go into a bit more detail on with the green, yellow, and red, like the stoplight, like we saw before. And it has the concept of target weight. So target weight or dry weight, you may have heard one of your healthcare practitioners refer to in the past, is a really important notation, so you know what you're where you should be aiming for, and so you can look for changes. That one doesn't seem to be projecting quite as well, but this one is an even nicer little monitoring or management chart, because it also includes activity and blood pressure. So if you have a blood pressure cuff at home after you take your weight in the morning, is a good time to get an idea of what your blood pressure and your heart rate are like. You can record your activity and whether you have any symptoms or signs of heart failure. So it really helps you to kind of refresh every day what those symptoms are. We're going to go into a little more detail about these zones. Just for patients who are asking questions, feel free to ask questions in the Q&A section, and I'll address those at the end of the presentation. So the first zone that we're going to talk about is the green safe zone. So this one gives you the thumbs up. This is the all clear. This is where you want to be. Your symptoms are under control. You have no shortness of breath or chest discomfort. There's no swelling in your ankles, legs, or feet or stomach. And you haven't had significant weight gain. And I think this definition is really important. And it speaks to why we want you to write down your weight. So significant weight gain, we talk about more than 4 pounds over 2 days. So usually we say 2 pounds over 2 days consecutively, or more than 5 pounds in a week. And if you measure in kilos, then there's also kilos there for you. So more than 2 kilos over 2 days, or more than 2.5 kilos in a week. And so this is the area where you want to be. And this is where all your healthcare practitioners want to work for you to live. It's inevitable that during your journey with heart failure that you may end up in the yellow zone. And I think that's okay. And what you have to remember is that this is just a warning. But the most important point on this slide is that when you get into this zone, it's important to contact your healthcare provider. And here are some key features. So if you do have that significant weight gain, which we talked about previously, if you're sick, so if you're having vomiting or diarrhea that's lasting for more than 2 days and you're not able to take any oral intake in, you're not keeping water down, keeping food down, this can affect how your body processes your medications. So it's really important that you do let your healthcare practitioners know so that we can adjust medications if you need to. If you feel more short of breath or notice increased swelling, if you have a new cough, if you feel tired, lightheaded, or dizzy, if you're feeling just that something's just not right, or if you're finding it harder to breathe when you're lying down at night, having to prop yourself up with pillows, those are all symptoms of heart failure and reasons why you should contact one of your healthcare providers. Looking at these symptoms, some of them certainly can overlap with COVID symptoms and what everyone's being told about, not necessarily fevers, but shortness of breath and coughing. And so it's important to contact your healthcare provider on how to proceed. And certainly having something like a COVID infection could make your heart failure worse. But it's a, definitely a distinction that we're happy to help you make. If you do go beyond the yellow zone, and sometimes it's not a matter of missing the yellow zone, sometimes things can go straight into the red zone. And this is the emergency or the danger zone. And it's important to go to the emergency room or call 911 if you have any of the following issues. So if you're struggling to breathe, or you have shortness of breath that doesn't go away while you're sitting, if you have a fast heartbeat that doesn't slow down when you rest, if you're having chest pain that's not going away with rest or your usual medication, if you're having trouble thinking or you're feeling confused, or if you fainted, these are all reasons why you need to see someone emergently. And it's important, even in the time of COVID, that you call 911 and seek emergency care. And we'll talk a little bit more about those details about in the time of COVID. But right now, but I, you know, these are your general principles, and the emergency ones definitely don't change. When we're talking about taking your medicine, it's really important to make sure that you're taking the right doses at the right times in the right way. And this can be extremely confusing, and we know this. So medications all have multiple names. They can be prescribed in different ways. Different doctors might talk about how to take them in different ways. And so what's important is that you make sure that you have a list of your medications, and that your care team is aware of how you're taking them so that we can make adjustments. Some helpful tips include using a weekly pill box, or if you have the ability to get your medications blister packed, that can be quite handy, and that can be done through the pharmacy. We want you to create reminders with notes or alarms, so there can be apps if you're technologically inclined, or even a post-it note on the fridge to remind yourself to take your medications at the appropriate time. If you have questions about whether to take your medications with other medications or with food, your pharmacist is always a good part of your care team to ask some of those questions too. And most important, to make sure that you have an up-to-date and accurate medication list, and that you bring it with you to every health visit. So as a cardiologist, one of the most important things I do is adjust patients' medications. And it's very difficult for me to do this if I don't know what medication you're taking and how you're taking them. And not just the pills, but we need to know the milligrams on the bottles or the milligrams of the pills that you're taking. So having an up-to-date list is a really important part of your care plan. When we're looking at choosing heart-healthy foods and choosing those low in sodium, it can be a very complicated process. But what we want you to aim for is about 2,000 milligrams or 2 grams of sodium per day. And it's important to recognize a teaspoon of salt has more than your recommended daily dose of sodium. And as you can see from the graph on the left, that the average Canadian diet, most of the sodium comes from ready-made processed foods and restaurant meals. And this, you know, may have changed a little bit in the last couple of months with everything going on, but the ready-made processed foods are still those, you know, sleepers in the grocery store that can have a lot of sodium in them without us knowing. A lot of our heart failure patients are good about not adding salt to their cooking or keeping it on the table, and then there's a pretty small proportion of food that has naturally occurring salt that we have to avoid. Physical activity is important, and these are the Canadian guidelines for recommended exercise. So it says in adults 18 to 64, but certainly for older adults, we definitely recommend similar amounts of exercise. So trying to accumulate at least 150 minutes of moderate to vigorous intensity exercise in at least bouts of 10 minutes or more. And everyone who's participated in cardiac rehab has heard these before. It's beneficial to add in resistance training at least 2 days per week. And the more active you are, the greater health benefits you're going to have. So the more activity that you do during the day, the more exercise minutes to a certain limit that you can participate in, the more health benefits you'll see. And when we're talking about cardiac rehab, more specifically in heart failure, it really does improve heart failure symptoms. It improves quality of life. It improves functional capacity, and it reduces reduces heart failure hospitalizations. So this is why it's so important. We don't recommend exercise training for unstable heart failure patients, but often patients that are referred to cardiac rehab have been, you know, deemed stable at the time by their healthcare provider. And if that changes, then certainly that's, you know, that's when it's important to be self-monitoring for symptoms and changes in your health status. We know that heart failure patients, even those that have pretty significant limitations initially, have benefit in exercise training, and it's safe for them. And the good news is that no matter who you are, so whether you're male or female or other, or your ethnic background, your baseline exercise capacity, or the reason you have heart failure, everyone benefits from physical activity when it comes to heart failure. We want to get that word out there, because despite the fact that we have really good data on safety and really good data on efficacy, there's a low number of referral and there's a low number of use and adherence to cardiac rehab by patients with heart failure. So it's an important part of the heart failure care plan, because we can have all these benefits. So these are benefits directly for heart failure, but cardiac rehab can also have benefits on other things for risk factors for heart failure. So if you don't have heart failure, but you're at risk, then certainly participating in cardiac rehab and being physically active can help to reduce your chances. So it lowers the risk of a second heart surgery or heart attack, reduces the overall risk of dying or having a future cardiac event, can lessen chest pain, and in some cases reduce the need for medication. So this can be for those treating angina. We want you to control your risk factors, so it can help with controlling high blood pressure and high cholesterol, and can in some cases help with weight loss. So when you look at all the different components of a cardiac rehab program, you can understand why it's an important part of heart failure care. So not only does it involve exercise, but it involves management for medication therapy. It involves adopting healthy diet, reducing stress, and stop smoking. So all of these things help to reduce risks for recurrent heart failure exacerbations, but also for developing heart failure. And cardiac rehab really is part of the picture when it comes to managing heart failure. And it can seem a bit overwhelming with all of these different components, but cardiac rehabilitation really sets you up with the kind of self-management tools to be able to participate in your care in this way. And it's about understanding, you know, the different things that you can control, and about when to ask for help from your healthcare team. So if this wasn't, you know, complicated enough, then we had COVID-19 come into our lives earlier this year. And I think, like I mentioned, it's difficult to talk about health conditions right now without addressing kind of the elephant in the room. So we'll just tackle it head on. So we'll just talk briefly. I'm sure everybody already knows this about COVID-19, and I was informed by my infectious disease colleagues that the proper name is actually SARS-CoV-2. So I thought I'd throw that in there in case anyone's heard that name as well. But it is a human coronavirus, and it causes infections of the nose, throat, and lungs. It is spread through respiratory droplets. So we're fortunate that it hasn't been shown to be transmitted through the air. It does tend to spread with close, prolonged personal contact, and touching something with the virus on it and then touching your mouth, nose, or eyes before washing your hands is generally how transmission occurs. In Canada, vulnerable populations are considered those over 65, those with compromised immune systems, and those with underlying medical conditions. When we talk about reducing the risk, the most important things that you can do are stay at home and avoid big groups, wash your hands often, clean high-touch surfaces often in your home or in your place of work if you're still working, keeping your distance from people is really important. And I think that all the efforts that everyone has made with physical distancing in the last couple of months have shown, you know, the ability to be able to prevent a giant swing in the pandemic. And even though I know everyone's getting quarantine fatigue, it is an important component of managing this going forward. The recommendation from Health Canada is to wear a non-medical mask when physical distancing isn't available or if you're in closer public areas. And if you think you might have symptoms, you can take a self-assessment tool on the web, and you can just Google Health Canada coronavirus. And in Ontario specifically, we're now moving to a new form of testing or a new level of testing, and you can allow asymptomatic patients as well as symptomatic patients for testing. You can call telehealth or call your primary care provider if you have questions. So when we're talking about COVID-19 and cardiac disease in specific, I'm going to get a bit scientific on you here, but I think that you can all imagine that the data is evolving when it comes to how COVID-19 is going to interact with cardiac disease and heart failure in particular. We know that COVID-19 can affect multiple things in the body that can affect cardiac function. So it causes inflammation, it can cause endothelial dysfunction or issues with the functioning of the inside of the arteries. It can actually attack cells in certain cases, as we've seen, and it has been shown to cause certain types of heart attacks to become more common. So we do know that it can have all these effects. We're not entirely sure to what degree all of these effects will have. But I think that it's important to know that all of these things are being investigated and looked into, and the cardiac community at large is really working hard to get as much information as possible. What does it mean for heart failure patients? So heart failure patients are considered part of the vulnerable population. It's very important to follow whatever public health recommendations are being made in your area. So as different areas differentially open across the province and across the world, it's important to know kind of what you should be doing in your own area. Stay home and avoid gatherings as much as possible, and it's really unclear what the long-term risk to heart failure patients is specifically. Patients who develop COVID-19 may be at higher risk of developing heart failure, but I think that would be an overstatement at this point. Certainly, if you were to develop cardiac complications, you may be at higher risk, but I think the overall impact is still very unclear, and this will have to only give us more answers as time goes on. When it comes to accessing care, I think, this is probably the most important slide in this slide deck. But if you're in need of emergent care, it's important to call 911. So delaying treatment for emergent issues is likely to cause serious health problems. And this is over and above, any health problem that you would get by going into hospital. And we're fortunate, I can say this about Ontario, that we do have the capacity to protect patients from COVID transmission in terms of PPE and the processes in place. We do have the capacity to treat patients with emergencies. And I think we always have during this pandemic. So I think it's just important that no matter what happens going forward, to know that these emergency services are available for you. When it comes to accessing urgent care, so if you're thinking about symptoms more in the yellow zone, it's important to call your healthcare provider. So most physicians' offices are offering virtual care in the province, and/or seeing urgent patients in person. And this is likely to become more prevalent in the next couple of weeks as things start to safely try to offer more services. And it's safer to be assessed outside of the emergency room if possible, meaning if the services are available in your area and if you're not requiring emergent care. When it comes to accessing care for routine care, again, most physicians' offices are trying to offer virtual care appointments. And if you're concerned, it's best to just contact your healthcare provider. There are virtual walk-in clinics available in some areas. And so, you know, really, if there's something you're concerned about, let us know. And I think you probably will have encountered all of this before, but you probably wouldn't be surprised anymore if routine appointments were postponed or tests were postponed or non-urgent blood work was postponed. Most of your physicians will have gone through their patients and tried to look at tests and blood work and things and appointments and try to, you know, see urgent cases. But we're all human. And if you're concerned that a test or an appointment or blood work is, you know, important and should be done and it hasn't been, then contact your healthcare provider and have the discussion about that. So use your voice and speak up, as the video said. So really important points with a routine care and management are: do not stop your medication. So do not stop. Make sure that you get your prescription refills. And if that means having the pharmacy deliver or having a family member who's not part of, you know, the vulnerable population to go and pick them up for you, continue your monitoring as recommended by your healthcare provider. So the more information, especially in this time of COVID, that you can give to us either in a virtual encounter or when you're seeing your care provider in terms of blood pressures and heart rates and weights, the better care we can provide for you. And I think this last point is important as well. Have discussions with your family and your care providers about goals of care. So this is always an important point for patients with chronic disease or who are, you know, are older adults. But in this situation, even more imperative to know that if you have certain wishes, that you have those discussions with your family or your care provider, and that it's important to think about, you know, whether you'd want invasive therapies or how much intervention, you know, would work with your quality of care goals. So thinking about your journey, we talked a lot about physical health today, but emotional health is incredibly important as well. Finding support from others who have heart failure, staying connected with what matters to you most, and keeping in contact with your care team. I thought this was interesting because this slide was produced much, you know, before COVID, and it talks about your new normal. And I think, you know, we're all struggling to kind of find what our new normal is at this time. But it's important to speak up about how you feel and how you know your body best, and also to celebrate what you can do versus what you can't do. Sticking with your treatment plan is very important. And everyone's journey is going to look different. So it's important to make sure that your journey, you know, is specific to your individual care plan. And I think just important not to stop believing. So you have the tools to be able to manage this, have some confidence in your skills, and, you know, you can achieve those goals. And the cardiac rehab programs that you're involved in, whether it's UHN or otherwise, are you know, there to help support you in developing those goals. And so I think from there, we'll move into some questions. So we have a few questions here in the Q&A. So I'll just start from the top. After each meal, I feel tired. I'm not sure what that other word was. Is this normal? So I think that after eating, certainly. So if you have heart failure, anything that you do that asks for extra exertion or asks for extra energy can certainly make you feel tired. And so in some cases, if you have significant symptoms, you can feel more tired after you've had a meal or after you've exercised. And as long as, you know, that recovers in a shorter period of time, I think that that's fairly normal. If you find that this is something that's persisting and it's worse than it was before, you know, it's something to definitely talk to your healthcare provider about. If you were finding you were so extremely exhausted after a meal that you were having to have a nap every time, then that would be something to explore. But certainly, you know, having breaks and learning to manage your energy with energy conservation techniques can be something, especially in the more severe stages of heart failure, that can be really important in your care. Another question, some of the symptoms that may indicate heart failure seem to be more subjective, more shortness of breath than normal, more tiredness and more discomfort. Are there diagnostic tests that can give a definitive diagnosis? So I think that's a really good point. So that is very true. So shortness of breath and tiredness and discomfort can certainly be subjective. And I think that's why we emphasize, you know, knowing what's normal for your body and monitoring your symptoms. So it's important to know what your normal is so that you can tell when things are abnormal. But certainly if you, there are tests and there are physical examination maneuvers and other things that your healthcare providers can use to help to tell whether you're having, you know, issues with volume overload or more significant problems from your heart failure. And if you're having any of those symptoms, then certainly, you know, getting in touch with your healthcare provider to be able to do other testing. And, you know, the first step usually is always to bring you into the office to do a physical exam. Because the majority of the time, you know, we can look to see if our patients are volume overloaded with our physical exam or with potentially an ultrasound at the bedside to take a look and see what volume status looks like and go from there. Sometimes it requires things like an echocardiogram to see if there's any progression of or deterioration in heart function or progression of valvular disease or otherwise. And, you know, sometimes if coronary artery disease is an issue, it might mean we have to do something like a stress test in order to identify if there's any problems. So absolutely, there are diagnostic tests that can often help. But it is important to know what those subjective differences mean for you. Another question here. I think it's patients with a stent still within the first year. Is it more likely that we may not survive if we've got COVID? So I think it's speaking to patients with coronary artery disease, if you would be considered kind of part of the vulnerable population. So I think that would be definitely fair to consider. So if Health Canada lists anybody with an underlying condition to be in a more vulnerable population, everybody who has coronary artery disease or heart failure can have varying degrees of illness, and that can certainly impact how significant the COVID infection could be. The other thing is we can't predict how severe everyone's COVID reaction or COVID infection is going to be for them and how it will affect them. We don't have a good idea about who will get mild symptoms and who will get severe symptoms. So I think what is important is to know that if you have an underlying health condition, that it's important to try to do what you can to you know, avoid transmitting the disease or avoid being in situations where you're higher risk to contract the disease, and really being diligent with hand washing, cleaning your high touch surfaces and keeping your physical distance from people. And that's really, you know, the best way to protect yourself at this point. So I think that's all the questions I can see in the Q&A. Is there anyone else who has a question that they wanted to ask? All right. Well, thank you guys very much for your attention and your participation today. And I hope that I've given you some useful tools and useful information. And I think knowledge really is the first step on getting on the road to developing your own heart failure care plan. And I'm going to turn it over to Crystal now, because I think she has a few things to talk to you guys about for next time.
Hello, thank you so much, Ashlay, for the great presentation today. Just letting everybody know about tomorrow's session, it will be on sodium and blood pressure, and we have our registered dietitians, Fatim and Veronica, joining us for that presentation. And then on Tuesday, June 2nd at 10 a.m. is our next Women's Series class. It's going to be a live exercise class with one of our cardiac rehabilitation supervisors, Lauren Jenkinson, and she's doing the ABCs of exercise, 26 ways to add activity to your day. So hopefully you're able to join us for that, and everybody is welcome to join. Thank you all very much, and wishing you a great day.